It's an enormous pleasure for me to introduce to Matilde Raffa Cuomo, not only because of what she's done, but also because I've had the pleasure, sort of pleasure, to work with her in fighting for the advanced placement exam program, the advanced placement program in Italian, and I must say that we were successful. So, but. That's just one of the many things for which she has dedicated her life to service. She's the founder of Mentoring USA. She has long been a respected and distinguished advocate on behalf of women, children, and families. As First Lady of New York State, she diligently worked as a volunteer with state and elected officials, as well as community leaders, to establish programs to prevent child abuse, strengthen families, promote adoption for foster care children, and prevent school dropout. Mrs. Cuomo has been described as the most active First Lady in New York State's history. She's chaired and served as chief spokesperson for the New York State Decade of the Child Initiative, co-chaired the Governor's Commission on Child Care, and chaired the New York State Citizens Task Force on the Prevention of Child Abuse and Neglect. In addition, Mrs. Cuomo led New York State's participation in the United Nations 1990 World Summit for Children in the U.S., for children and the U.S. ratification of the U.N. Convention on the Rights of the Child. At the request of the governor to prevent high school dropout, Mrs. Cuomo established in 1987 the New York State Mentoring Program, our nation's first statewide school-based one-to-one mentoring program. In 1995, she established Mentoring USA to continue the goals of the New York State Mentoring Program after it was eliminated by the new administration. Take a moment to pause. Since its inception, Mentoring USA has expanded nationally and internationally with an affiliate, Mentoring USA Italia, which celebrated the 10th anniversary in 2008 and is now in Spain, Bulgaria, and Latvia. Mrs. Cuomo is the widow of the former governor of New York State, Mario Cuomo. She is a graduate of St. John's University's Teachers College, where she met her husband. They were married in 1954, and together have 5 children, 14 grandchildren, and she lives in New York City. And she's our neighbor. Matilda?
Well, good morning. I still think it's morning. Good morning, everyone. I just want to thank Anthony Tambori. I mean, having him as the head of the Calandra Institute, you will have to understand that my husband must be still very happy that he became president, because he's been so devoted. And this to Mario, we knew John Calandra. We sort of grew up with him. And to have him pass on so early in life was such a tragedy. Such a great life he would have had, my God. You sometimes wonder, why does God do these things? But anyway, it must be a reason. But to keep on the fervor of that man and the wonderful beauty of the thoughts he had for the future of all Italian Americans, John Calandra, Mario started this organization, and it's gone through very good presidents, but this fella, he's imbued with getting it to the heights. And I want to thank him very much. On behalf of my husband, this book is an amazing encyclopedia, and I think it's wonderful. I hope you're selling it and getting it around to all the Italians, at least.
Yeah, but it's public funds. It goes back to the university.
Because, you know, it's needed. It's needed. We all have to get more educated in this. And it helps a lot. You did the work for us. My God, just to seeing the bars in the book, you know. As a teacher, I love to do that with the kids, to show them in variation the changes. And so it doesn't take your imagination. You see it right there. So I think we should spread it around. I'll try to help you with that, to get it into the schools even. Okay. Thank you very much. I love to say your names, because... Vincenzo Milione, Carmine Pizzi Russo, and Italia Pellizzoli. Beautiful names, really. I love that. I just want to start with my dad, my father. because I think you'll all understand how where I come from. This man came as a young married fellow from Sicily to this country, to our country, because he felt he was an American citizen born in Pennsylvania. Why? A group of Sicilian men couldn't get work in Sicily. Who was that? Mussolini at the time, I think. As strong as he was, he didn't provide work in Sicily. And they all got together, these Sicilian men, because my brothers and I, we couldn't believe why they left Italy. And they come to Pennsylvania to the coal mines. And that's where a lot of Italians, I found out, did go for jobs in our country. Well, he told my mother, Maria, to stay in Sicily with the firstborn son, Frank, Francesco. Why? I may not like the country, I'm coming back, because he had, he was a master carpenter. He had young people who he would teach furniture, making furniture, whatever. In other words, he had a good practice of, a good profession of his own, not to have to come to America. He could have done well in Italy. So he's a young, handsome guy. He really was. And what happens is he loved the country. He loved it when he got here. My mother had five aunts, so he would go 2 weeks with one aunt, with another, because he had no money, but he survived. Now, what happens? He has my mother come with her son, and he suffered. He was handsome. I say only that because he suffered because the people, even then, didn't like what an Italian should look like, you know, or whatever, but they didn't trust him, like, you know. In an open truck, they put him in the back when it was snowing, and he almost froze to death. And finally, it was just one fellow on the side who was not driving. The driver wanted him to sit in the middle to keep him warm, but the other one wouldn't let him in the front cabin. So he was looking through the glass, and one fellow said to the other, what's the matter with you? He's going to freeze out there. He said, well, he said he's a Guinea, a WAP. He's not coming to sit here. And these were two white fellows. You know, you wonder what's going on in their minds. How bad could my father be? And I always say he was handsome and he wouldn't hurt anybody. They finally let him in, and they saved his life. He would have frozen for sure. So he couldn't even touch his arms. He was so frozen, he told me, told us the story. I told all my kids this story. I keep telling it because, you know, it came to be. My father had already a wonderful little factory in Brooklyn. And then these two men came looking for a job 15 years later. And they recognized my father, and my father recognized them. And they both looked at each other, and they said, let's go, he's not gonna give us a job. My father says, wait. He said, I'll give you a job, but let me tell you something. What you did was wrong. Don't ever do it again. And I just think you should bring those lessons he told them to your family, because we have to stop that. We have to stop that. That was not nice. He could have died, my father, you know, right then and there. But anyway, the fact is that he, as he grew, he became the largest builder of supermarkets in the Northeast. I just went to a party for Castamatidis, who owns Christidis, and he always gives me a hug, and he says, your father built all my stores. I said, I know. But I'm very proud of my father, and so was Mario Cuomo. Because as soon as my father met him, I don't know if he liked Mario, liked my father more than me, but he came very close to both of us. But the fact is, though, my father, Mario, we always believed in education, especially for our children, that's the prime concern for parents. Make sure your children are educated. That's where it all comes from. So I just wanted to tell you that I myself am very thrilled that at this point in time that I can look back, because I was not in favor of Mario getting into politics. I wouldn't lie to you. I didn't think he was going to do that. I thought he'd be a professor, maybe go to Harvard, you know. But he got into it because of the 69 home people in South Ozone Park that were losing their homes. They needed somebody, and Jimmy Breslin came to Mario and said, help them out, they're going to be homeless. All these different occasions, and that's what happened. But he got into politics for good reasons. He was really meant for it. He really was. So the fact is, though, you mentioned, Anthony, that when Mario became governor, he had 12 to 15-year-olds incarcerated in the prisons, filled with these young people. So one morning, he's shaving. I'll tell you just the way it happened. And the chief of state police, who comes in with his gray outfit and the hat and everything, he comes in. His name was Constantine. And he let him in to the area where he was doing his shaving. And he said, give me the report. He said, what's going on with the prisons? He said, all these kids, 12 to 15, are incarcerated, Governor. So he said, oh, my God. He was nicking himself with the razor. He was all full of blood. Cotton. He called me, Matilda. I said, oh, my God, what are you doing? And he says to me, I got this terrible information. My God. And he just became governor in 1982. So he said, what am I going to do? This is terrible. He said, you're a teacher. Think of something quick. I said, wow, I was already into health and nutrition for kids and stuff. I said, okay. He said, you must stop everything and give it your full attention as a teacher, a mother, a grandmother. I said, okay. And I thought, what best, you know, way I could do this? What would be a good methodology? Because a child, I know when you're teaching, you lose a lot of the kids because they don't look or listen or whatever, you know, they don't give you attention. But if you could get them in a one-to-one situation and look at them eye to eye and find out what's the matter, why are you doing this in school? Why do you behave so badly? Why do you get yourself in trouble? They open up. Kids open up. In psychology, they do this methodology, too. You have to do the one-to-one. I said, all of this, Big Brothers, Big Sisters were wonderful, but they had group settings for this this kind of helping situation to help the kids, but it didn't work. I went to many of them, and I see the kids who needed it the most were in the back talking and not paying attention. So I said to myself, it has to be one-to-one. Now, that was difficult, because that meant you had to have a mentor who's a volunteer, train them one-to-one and get the right amount of people. So it was not easy. But I thought that was the only way I'd like to do it, so to get it done properly. Well, it worked. It was the first in the country. I am proud to say that it's not only was needed, is needed, and will be needed. Why? Because there are a lot of families that are not intact. A lot of parents are working. They don't have time for the child. A lot of parents don't have two parents. They have only one parent. Maybe they have none at all. They're foster care kids. We're right now burdened with thousands and thousands of foster care kids in our agencies in New York City alone. In fact, they're in the newspapers because two kids were murdered, actually, mishandled. So, to make a long story short, what happens? The program ran beautifully, one-to-one, the New York State Mentoring Program, everybody got to know it. Then Mario loses the election, 1994, I'm skipping along, and I was very surprised because who told me? My son Andrew. He always gives me good and bad news. And I said, Andrew, why don't you tell me? I'm fixing my apartment. What do you want? He said, well, Mom, there's no more program. And I said, don't kibitz, don't fool around. He said, no, Mom, you got to do something. So what do you expect me to do? He said, well, call it Mentoring USA. He said that model works. It's marvelous. Nobody will be able to do better than that model. He said, so all you do is you go now national, international. Daddy can't stop you. I said, that's true. So we called it Mentoring USA. And in one room, and he gave me a subterranean room in one of the help facilities for the homeless. And all we saw with my two volunteers were legs going back and forth. I said, thanks a lot. He's very generous. But anyway, the Mentoring USA is still functioning. We're in Italia, Andalusia, Morocco. I met Queen Sophia in Spain, and very nice episode because my mother had her 90th birthday. I had to go back home. She didn't want me to go. She got very infuriated that I was leaving. I said, but it's my mother and it's her birthday. I said, I'll see you again. She couldn't understand. So in any case, we're now going to Holland. They just actually, I got word about a month ago now, that they need it very badly. We're in England, many, many countries want the program. So it's very interesting to see children of children, and the need is there. So I just wanted you to know that Mentoring USA is coming now. 2015, Andrew reinstates the original New York State Mentoring Program. Because Governor Pataki in 1994, when Mario lost his election, by the way, by 3 points, 3 percentage points, which was a shame because he had so much more he wanted to do. And the fact is that that's why everybody should vote and not take anything for granted. The fact is in 2015, Andrew came to me and said, we have a lot of troubles again, Mom. You got to get that program going again. So that's what I'm doing right now. It's been reinstated. I tell you all this because the bottom line is education. No matter who you are, you know, what you believe in, your religion, your authenticity, or whatever, you have to have your children educated. That's the best thing you can do. My father's only goal was to put his 5 kids through college, and he did. And we're very proud of it, all of my brothers and sisters. 2 were engineers. My sister and I are teachers, and Sam is a lawyer. So, you know, I feel my father died happy because he was beaten up. I was telling somebody earlier in one of his supermarkets that he still owned, in a ruse to get him down in the basement, they beat him up, and he died from that injury. So the fact is that it's something that we have to think about. Not give up. Not give up. You have to help your children. Now, I know you have a long program here going on, but I'll do anything I can to help anybody who you know needs help in this area to get them educated in the sense of keeping the kids in school. I will help. And I have to tell you that I think of the Pope. I was so blessed to see him in my last trip to Italy. And he looked at me, and I had my book under my arm. I'm sorry, I rushed out, I didn't. But my book is available. It's The Person Who Changed My Life. It's the one-to-one true stories of famous people who tell you who their mentor was. So nobody does everything on their own. Mm-hmm. And as he's talking to me, and he's telling me, La Familia. Mm-hmm. He's going, La Familia. And I'm looking at him because I had a lot to tell him, but he overwhelmed me. And I said, Ma, sì, è vero, la famiglia. And I talked to him a little bit about my family and everything. And then he grabs my book. I didn't even know I'm talking to him, and he grabs the book. He wanted the book quicker than I was going to give it to him. I just am so imbued with the way he said this to me, that La Familia means so much. Where you're sitting here right now, you are like a family. You came here for all the right reasons. You came for this beautiful book, fabulous book that we all should. By the way, did you give this to the governor?
Not yet.
I'm not giving him mine. You have to send him a book. You should give it to all the officials. Really, I'm serious. Okay. So I'm just saying that you are a family here. We have, many people couldn't come this morning, I'm sure. But we have to, if I learned anything in everything we've been able to achieve, you do it as a family. You don't do it alone. Everybody counts. You have a piece of it. Everybody has a piece of the pie. But we all have to work together, come together. What is really going, deterring you from going further more than you want to? How can I help? And that's what we did with the Italian language. I just insisted that if I get involved, you're all coming together, whether you don't want to talk to each other or not. And that's what I did in Washington, so with NEAF. So I tell you the truth, you're not going to get far if you don't do it this way. I'm 85 years old now. I'm in kindergarten. They need help. And the parents have to know that's prime. Whether they believe it or not, you have to get the parents in and talk to them. Don't give up. Find the facet where it's a weak chain and get it strong and make them understand. It's not easy, but you can do it. You can do it. We have proven that. So we mustn't go backwards. We made many strides. And I just say with all my heart, I have the 14 children, 13 girls, and one boy, little Mario. So I just want to do it for them. That's why I work hard. I want a better society, and I love being Italian. And I love teaching my kids everything about the Italian language. In fact, I'm bringing them all to Italy again. They all go and come and go. So as the Pope said, La Famiglia, please, we are a family. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Matilda. Our next scheduled speaker is Daniel Nigro, but unfortunately, because of some tragic events of last week, he's been called away. And we have, however, I'm very confident, an excellent person to fill in. John Benanti has been employed with the City of New York since June of 1981. In his 35 plus years in city government, he's been employed by five New York City agencies. Starting as an investigator with the New York City Law Department, John has risen through the ranks over the years, reaching the position of Deputy Commissioner, first with the Administration for Children's Services, and now as Deputy Fire Commissioner. John is a proud Italian-American who hailed from Staten Island, New York, and where he currently lives and resides with his wife and his children. John.
Good morning, everyone. And thank you very much, Vincenzo, for the invitation. And Mrs. Cuomo, you're a very hard act to follow, so I'm going to try my best. Just like Mrs. Cuomo, I do want to start just by saying a few words about my family, because I'm Italian and my family is very important. My grandparents were born in Catania and in Palermo. They moved to the United States in the early 1900s. My grandfather was a stonemason who had worked on the Empire State Building and on the Radio City Music Hall. My dad was a dressmaker. He had four brothers. Three of his brothers were dressmakers. And the fourth brother was a chief in the Internal Revenue Service. On my mom's side, my mom was a graduate of Hunter College. Her family had lived in Bensonhurst, Brooklyn. Mom had five brothers. One was killed during World War II. And of the other four, three of them were in trades. And the fourth one, my Uncle Ben, became the chief of security for the Ford Motor Company Eastern Region of the United States. However, he had to change his name. He had to drop the O at the end of his name. My mom's maiden name was Termato. He had to drop the O in order to gain employment, which I think in the 1930s was something that quite a few people had to do of Italian descent. Mom and Dad were married in the early 40s. They moved to Staten Island. They lived in an area called Dungan Hills, which is a very predominant Italian-American community back then, and it still is. Even now, Staten Island has about a 40% of the island residents are of Italian descent. So that's a little bit about my family. I've been a civil servant working in city government my entire career, which as of today is about 35 and a half years. Over those 35 plus years, I've worked at five New York City agencies. In looking through the 40 years book, while I can't speak of the overall Italian-American workforce in New York City, I can say, looking at the numbers and percents listed regarding Italian-Americans in city government, coupled with my own experiences, professional relationships, and longevity in service, that Italian-Americans still make up a considerable number of the current city workforce. My experiences have also showed me that some agencies, some positions within the agencies, are made up more heavily of Italian-Americans because of several factors, which I'll get into in a few minutes. Upon my graduation from St. John's University, I was hired by the New York City Law Department in 1981 as a workers' compensation investigator, and I had an annual salary of $12,500. At that time, while I don't recall a heavy Italian-American presence at the Law Department, many of my dealings were with other city agencies, and what sticks out in my mind most was the large number of Italian-Americans I came across at specific agencies, Department of Transportation, Department of Sanitation. In 1989, I left the law department and went to work for the mayor's office of contracts, and I was an assistant director there. When one works directly with the mayor's office, one deals on a daily basis with all the New York City agencies. So here my recollections show that on the capital construction agencies especially, Department of Design and Construction, Department of Transportation, Department of Sanitation. Again, predominantly I worked with Italian Americans, and by that time I was working at a mid-management level, so a lot of the mid-managers that I worked with during that time were Italian Americans. In 1992, I moved to the Department for the Aging. I became their chief contracting officer. Now, Aging was an agency made up of predominantly social workers with very low presence of Italian Americans. There weren't many in the field, at least when I was there. 1997, I was interviewed for a position as assistant commissioner, chief contracting officer for a new agency that was created by then Mayor Rudy Giuliani, the Administration for Children's Services. Excuse me. The man who interviewed me was Nicholas Scapetta. For those of you here, even if you know very little about city government or the major players over the past 40 years, I'm sure you know something about Nick Scapetta. What I will tell you is that in my 35 years of city government, he is without a doubt the person whom I've learned the most from. His reputation, his extremely high level of integrity, his wealth of municipal information, experience, his intelligence, and his use of simple common sense are all aspects of this man that I admired and I aspired to be like. Nick passed away earlier this year. Miss him all every day. Very proud to call him an Italian, this Italian American, my boss, my mentor, and my friend. And I had to say that about Nick. Nick had promoted me to Deputy Commissioner of ACS after 2 years of being his contract chief. Several years later, when Nick was appointed fire commissioner, he brought me over as one of his deputy commissioners. It was a no-brainer to move from ACS to go to the fire department. It was a no-brainer to work for Nick. And, you know, what little boy doesn't want to be a fire commissioner? As deputy fire commissioner, I oversee the larger civilian bureaus of the department, most notably the fleet and the facilities. Here, there are many Italian-American workers, mainly as trade staff, my carpenters, plumbers, electricians, and mechanics. And doesn't it make sense that the trades, perhaps because of our fathers and grandfathers, are predominantly Italian-Americans? One thing I am most proud of, and certainly fortunate to have experienced, is that in my 8 years at the fire department, the three men that I've served under are all Italian-Americans. Nick Scapetta was followed by Salvatore Cassano. Sal was a career FDNY employee. He started as a probationary firefighter in 1969 and rose through the ranks. He covered every rank up to fire commissioner in 2010. He was followed by my current commissioner, Commissioner Dan Nigro. Dan was also from that same class of 1969 and was promoted to chief of department after the towers fell on 9/11. A point I'd like to note is that the chief of department prior to Commissioner Nigro was another Italian-American, Chief Peter Gansey. Chief Gansey was killed on September 11th, and I have to tell you, 15 years after that date, as I walk around fire department headquarters, there are so many people that still have Chief Gansey's picture on their desks. He was that much loved by the department. I couldn't be more proud to be working at the fire department for a commissioner who, like myself, is an Italian-American who has risen through the ranks in a city and state whose two top executives, the governor and the mayor, are Italian-Americans as well. Final note, I would be remiss if I did not mention the FDNY Columbia Association, almost 1,700 members strong. The association was established in 1934 after a fire department captain, John Capillo of Engine 28, submitted to his authorities a request to write a brief for the purpose of instructing people of the city what to do in case of a fire. Captain Capillo was concerned because of serious losses of life from recent fires in tenement houses occupied by mostly Italian Americans. The concern for the entire city became the impetus, and this started the Columbia Association. So now to this day, one of the greatest contributions in city government made by the fire department is fire safety and education. Also know that the Italian Americans through the Colombians promote a high level of competence and skills in the performance of their regular duties and promote better fire education, not only for our Italian American children, but for all children in New York City. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. As we move on to our next speaker, we remain happily in Staten Island. Diane Savino has dedicated her entire professional career towards improving the lives of working families. She began her career in public service as a caseworker for New York City's Child Welfare Administration, providing direct assistance to abused and neglected children. As an active member of her local union, the Social Service Employees Union, she quickly rose through the ranks to become the Vice President for Political Action and Legislative Affairs, where she became one of the most respected labor leaders in New York State. As a labor official, she actively and successfully campaigned for an increase in the minimum wage from $5.15 to $7.50, the first raise for New Yorkers in over a decade. As a senator and chair of the Labor Committee, she continued her commitment to workers by supporting and advocating for a further increase. In 2004, she was elected to represent the 23rd Senatorial District, which encompasses the north and east shores of Staten Island and portions of southern Brooklyn, including Bensonhurst, Brighton Beach, Coney Island, Dyker Heights, Gravesend, and Sunset Park. In their endorsement of Senator Savino, the New York Times described her as, and I quote, scrappy and effective, end of quote. Her dedication to her constituents earned her the Staten Island Advances, and I quote, strongest endorsement for a third term, saying that no lawmaker works harder and no longer commits herself to the fight for her constituents more than Ms. Savino. City and state newspapers in fact, have rated her as one of the most 100 most influential people in New York State, and one of the most 100 most influential people in New York City. Senator Savino's hard work and influence was evidenced as she championed the Compassionate Care Act through the legislative process, despite opposition and misinformation. The act allows New Yorkers with serious mental conditions limited access to medical marijuana under the supervision of healthcare professionals and under strict state regulations. Senator Savino currently serves as chair of the State Standing Committee on Banking and has previously served as chair of the Labor Committee, the Civil Service and Pensions Committee, and the Children and Families Committee. In January of 2011, speaking of effective, Senator Savino co-founded the Independent Democratic Conference to provide a clear break from the dysfunction that had defined Albany far too long and to allow for a return to governance for her constituents that her constituents expect and deserve. She serves at the Independent Democratic Conference's liaison to the executive chamber. Without further ado, Diane Savino.
Thank you, Anthony. And I brought my book with me. Actually read it. First, thank you. First, I want to apologize for having been late. I found out that it now takes longer to get across town than it does to get from Albany. So I've made a decision. I'm never leaving Staten Island again. Anybody wants to meet with me, you can come and see me there. I'm only going to be in Albany or Staten Island and nowhere else ever again. But I am very happy to be here today. I'm always happy, by the way, to be in a room with the wonderful Matilda Cuomo. She really is. Every time I am with you, I am reminded why you are my favorite Cuomo. And you can tell your son that. You really are. You are my favorite. But continuing a theme here, we have three speakers. And all of us are St. John's graduates. I don't know what that says. But I just recently hit a milestone in my career. On September 17th was the 26th anniversary of my becoming a civil servant. So 26 years ago, September 17th, I became a caseworker in the city's child welfare system. I was actually one of the first civil servants in my family. And that's kind of consistent. You'll see that with a lot of Italian Americans. Long before there were studies on, you know, the number of Italian Americans, or long before there were city unions and long before there were civil servants, there was Tammany Hall. So in order to really understand why you have a representation of Italian Americans or any ethnicity, quite frankly, in any city agency or any title or anywhere in government, is you have to go back to where we started in government service. So it was originally all political patronage. And in order to get a job in government, you had to be willing to pay your dues to whatever the political class was. So you go back to Tammany Hall, and they generally would utilize whatever the immigrant population was. And so if you go back originally, it was predominantly the Irish. So if you look at the history of the fire department, and if you look at the snapshot now, and think about this, there's a lot made about the ethnicity of the fire department and why it seems to be all Irish and somewhat Italian. And there's this a belief among some that there's a discriminatory pattern. And that's simple if you look at it from the 10,000 foot level. But there is history and there's tradition and there's family tradition in the fire department that goes back to the days long before Teddy Roosevelt ever envisioned creating the civil service merit system. Before anyone thought of creating a level playing field for everyone, which, by the way, was what gave people, Italian immigrants, the opportunity to get a foot in the door. Because before the civil service merit system, Italians were never going to get a job in government. Language barriers, discrimination, distrust was what kept them out. That ability to sit down with a pencil and what was in their head and be able to compete against their neighbors was what got them in the door. So the civil service merit system really created opportunity for Italian immigrants and all other immigrants. But before that, it was simply political patronage and fraternal organizations. But even after that started, there was still, you know, discriminatory patterns, because people tend to gravitate towards their own ethnic groups. So Italians didn't really gravitate towards the occupations where the Irish were because they didn't feel welcome there. So it took a while for them to break into the fire department. And in fact, there were some amusing anecdotes about the Italians eventually getting into the fire department. And it usually starts with, well, when they introduced engine companies, they said, well, we can have Italians on the engine companies because they're short. The Irishmen can work on the ladder companies because they're tall, right? In the police department, they didn't want Italians in the police department because they didn't want them there. They didn't trust them because, you know, they're all in the mob. They're all mafiosos, so we can't have cops in the police department. But you know what? They can pick up the garbage. And that's how they all wound up in the sanitation department. So you had large numbers of Italians in sanitation. And then as the city began to run their own corrections department and run their own prisons, well, the Italians, they can become corrections officers too, because after all, they know all the criminals. That was the idea behind it. Eventually that shifted. Yeah, Anthony's laughing, but it's true. As the immigrant populations changed and you saw different groups coming in, you begin to see a change in city agencies as well. When I walked in the door of HRA, because at the time ACS didn't exist, it was all part of the super agency. When I walked in the door of HRA as a caseworker, I was one of very few Italian Americans who worked in child welfare. The majority of the people who worked there were African American women. And it was mothers and their daughters, and sometimes grandmothers, mothers and their daughters. There were generations of people who had committed themselves to this public service. Teachers, originally, many years ago, they were overwhelmingly Jewish. Social workers were overwhelmingly Jewish. So you saw these patterns in civil service that went back to predating civil service and early, you know, immigration patterns. And they have somewhat stuck in many of these agencies. But even still, it's hard to get away from the discrimination. During the years that I served in the legislature, I've chaired many committees, as Anthony said, and I've collected a lot of souvenirs along the way. When I chaired the Civil Service and Pensions Committee, I had someone send me a letter from Chicago. Because, by the way, this pattern of discrimination and assimilation is not unique to New York. It happened all across the country. I got this letter from Chicago, and I'm going to read it to you. So I'm going to put on my glasses. It is a letter from the Commissioner of Police, a guy named Michael Hughes. And it's dated May 26, 1923. And it's to the mayor of the city of Chicago, to Honorable Mayor William E. Dever. 1. Your Honor, I have discussed your suggestion at length with several precinct captains, reference to the purchase of three-wheel motorcycles for patrol duty. Also discussed was the suggestion that the department make an effort to employ a greater percentage of minority citizens, to wit, Italians and Italian Americans. 2. The general consensus of opinion from all I talked with was, without exception, opposed to the idea. The department has been very fortunate in being able to recruit in the main Irishmen from overseas and narrowbacks, and we should stick with success. 3, nothing I can presently think of would do more to ruin the Chicago Police Department than to implement the use of three-wheel motor vehicles and to start hiring Dagos in large numbers. Sincerely, Michael Hughes, Commissioner of Police. Now, as you can imagine, that was the opinion. In as early as 1923. But it was that sense of you're not welcome, coupled with already this fear of being discriminated against, that led a lot of Italians to just steer away from civil service in the beginning. Language barriers, fear of discrimination, not willing to go there. And so they didn't naturally go into civil service, even when the opportunities arose. But there was always this, you know, belief among family that you should get an education and improve yourself. So we've seen, I think, a greater percentage of Italian Americans in the education field than we have in other fields. Certainly we've seen, you know, Italian Americans in the trades, and we've seen them in skilled labor. But if you look at government, by and large, you will see a larger presence of Italian Americans in higher education and teaching, and in elementary and high school teaching, not necessarily in, you know, some of the other civil service. But I do think that we have an obligation to try and find ways to encourage Italian Americans to get more involved in government and to think of government and public service as a career path, because we have a lot to offer. I started as a caseworker, and you never know where life is going to take you. I certainly never imagine that I would become a state senator. But my experiences as a caseworker working with abused and neglected children has certainly helped me, you know, develop policy that will help deal with the chronic problems and the social issues that children and families deal with. My experience in the labor movement certainly helped me define, you know, policies that are effective for working families, you know, whether it was taking on the issue of domestic workers or helping raise the minimum wage 10 years ago, and again working with, you know, Governor Cuomo as we tried to raise the minimum wage, or delivering on a paid family leave program. So all of those experiences that we have will help make our government run better. We need good people in government now more than ever. And unfortunately, we're not attracting people. And so I think we need to do more, whether it's with reports like the one that you have just completed here, to give us that snapshot, doing more outreach, or encouraging more of our Italian-American youngsters in school to think about a career in public service. You know, there was a time where people looked down on government service, and they would, you know, look at us and say, well, that's the best job that you can get. Well, right now, if you have a job with job security and income security in your retirement and a pension, I think that's pretty damn good. And I think that's something that we should be encouraging people to consider. So I look forward to working further with the Calandra Institute on this project. And as always, I look forward to working with Anthony and his entire team on anything to promote Italian Americans in New York State. And I'm always happy to work with, you know, Mrs. Cuomo. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Tom Abinanti, who was elected to represent the 92nd Assembly District in November 2010. The 92nd Assembly District consists of the towns of Greenberg and Mount Pleasant in Westchester. Prior to his election to the Assembly, Tom was elected to represent the residents of Greenberg in the Westchester County Legislature 10 times. He was seen as a leader in preserving our environment, ending gun violence, protecting women's rights, and advocating for children and with special needs. He led the way to preserve hundreds of acres for parks, open space, and passed landmark clean air and clean water legislation. He authored laws to reform Westchester's gun regulations and to clean up the trash industry. He was instrumental in establishing the Westchester Medical Center as an independent public benefit corporation. Tom served as majority leader of the Westchester legislature 3 times. He served as chair of numerous committees, including rules, legislation, health, community affairs, and environment and energy. Previously, Tom served 2 terms as Greenberg Town Councilman, was legislative counsel to a member of Congress, and staff counsel to the New York State Assembly. He served as a prosecuting attorney for the villages of Ardsley and Dobbs Ferry, and he represented the Greensburg Housing Authority and served as a pro bono attorney for the Westchester Coalition for Legal Abortion. Tom Abinanti is a practicing attorney. He lives with his wife Janet Longo Abinanti and their son Justin. Janet is a science research teacher at Sleepy Hollow High School. Justin is a student at the Pleasantville Middle School in a special education program for children with autism. Tom's daughter, Nicole, is a medical doctor. She lives with her husband and their 3 children. Tom is a graduate of New York University School of Law, Fordham College, and Xavierian High School. He has taught continuing legal education courses for Pace Law School and courses in state and local government as an adjunct professor at Mercy College. Tom?
Thank you. These guys are a tough act to follow, I gotta tell you that. But I can say one thing that none of the others can say. Good afternoon. First, I very much appreciate your inviting me to join you here today. I have learned a lot just by sitting here and listening, and of course, I always, I have ADD. If you can't tell, you'll see it. And so I always passed exams by staying up the night before and reading all the materials, and then it's fresh in my mind and whatever school I went to. So it forced me to, coming here today forced me to read the book. So, and prepare for it. And I want to compliment you guys on this excellent presentation. I mean, the book, the presentation today was really superb. And you know, it's important that we do things like this, because the personal experiences drive us. But when you deal with policymakers, they want to see numbers. And if you don't have the numbers and you don't have things to review, you can't look to see what's working, what isn't working. So your works, this book, your presentations, et cetera, are so important. I can't tell you which way they're going to work, you know, who's going to use them where, but this is an important body of knowledge that we need to have. And maybe, just maybe, we should be doing this in other areas as well, to take a good look at what is our workforce? Where did they come from? What talents do they have? What skills do they have? What connections to what communities? There's so many different ways we can look at this, so I commend you and thank you for it. Matilda Cuomo, this is the first time we've had a chance to meet, and I've always wanted to meet you. I mean, she's charming, isn't she? She's such an engaging speaker, and there's so much substance to what she says. I find it interesting that she was able to tell personal stories and make it understandable to everybody, but at the same time teach. She must have been a fabulous teacher, because she is able to convey to us a message that is so important. And she did it in a fashion that was so enjoyable, just to sit here and listen. I could have listened to you for another hour. But I really very much appreciate that. Another hour. You only spoke for 15 minutes, but I could have listened to you for an hour or more. So it was superb. I guess I have a long-lost relative who I never met before. Don't we look alike? I mean, I guess either your family dropped the A,
at the beginning,
or mine added it, but Benanti and Abenanti, I was wondering, are we related? When I heard you say some of your family came from Palermo, so did some of my family. Now, my father wasn't too helpful on this, because he said that his family came from Ventimiglia, which means 20 miles, right? And he said it's near Palermo. For the life of me, I can't find a community called Ventimiglia near Palermo. But my guess is there was this road sign that said 20 miles to Palermo. And that's where the family lived. So going way back, we must be related. Nice to see you. Where do we go next? I'm going to try to give some random thoughts here, because these guys have covered just about everything. Let me start off with, if anybody is bored or hungry, I want to remind you there's coffee and and stuff out there, because I'm the last one coming up here, so by now you're probably tired. And don't worry, you can eat while we talk. In fact, it reminds me of a story of the current Governor Cuomo. When I was a county legislator, we were in Albany, and we were at a convention, New York State Association of Counties, and he was the featured speaker. And he came in, I guess it was while he was Attorney General, and he had the prime spot at lunch, but lunch was late. And so they wanted to bring out the food, and they're standing there by the door as they're introducing him. So he gets up and he says, I don't want to stand between you and your lunch. He said, so bring out the food and we'll talk and eat at the same time. He said, I'm used to that. I'm from an Italian family. And then he said, maybe I'll have something to eat while I'm talking also. And that brought down the house. It was a great way to start off a good relationship between the counties and the then Attorney General. So if any of you want to go out and get a snack, I won't be offended if you come back. Let's see, where do we go next? You know, I'm listening to the history, and I read it in the text. This book was excellent on the history also. I thought it was very interesting. You know, the history of immigrants is the history of this country. And the Italian Americans are no different. They had the same challenges that all immigrants had, and we've done pretty well. If you look, we've succeeded pretty well. There's still a long way to go. We haven't had a president yet, but we've governor of New York twice and several others as well. We're doing well in the states where we have large populations. You know, it's immigrate, and then it's educate, you know, learn not just the substantive material, but learn the mores of the country. And then it's assimilate, and then it's participate. And it's taken a while for us to do that, but we're finally starting to do that. And I think that's good. The importance of having Italian Americans as part of government can't be overstated. I want to suggest that by having different groups represented in government, you can affect policy. You bring a certain attitude that's been imbued in you, going back centuries, right? We're all a product of our past and our ancestors. So if we're going to be part of the fabric of this country and really have an impact on it, we've got to get involved in the places where policy is made. Secondly, I think we legitimize government. People are afraid of the other, which we all know is immigrants. You know, people are afraid of the new immigrants because they're other. And until we have people in important positions throughout the country, there's not going to be the feeling among the Italian-American community that's my government. They've got to see that they're participating. And frankly, that applies to every group that comes into this country. To make them assimilate and participate, you need to have those leaders out there, people who are representing the government. So I think it's really, so what you're doing here is important from the practical point of view. We want to see, are we actually accomplishing this goal of assimilation and participation? The other thing you mentioned in passing, I didn't see it in the book, but you mentioned it, and I think it's really important, and that is government service, and Diane did mention it also, is really the road to the middle class. And until enough Italian Americans realize that, we're still not going to make it into the middle class fully. And I'm a little disappointed because in this day and age, we're seeing more and more cutbacks. We're seeing more and more mechanization. We're seeing more and more privatization. And that's cutting back on the road to the middle class for so many people. And I, for one, believe in government. And unfortunately, as I see it, a lot of Italian Americans are skeptical of government. They don't see it as on their side. And I think it's the job of those of us who are elected to office, and also to those of people who are not elected, but who are the government, to make it clear to them that, no, we're trying to understand the entire community, and you're an important part of the community. And how do we make this government work for you? And I think that's really important. And I look and I see my uncle was, one of my uncles was with Con Edison. You know, that's almost the semi-government, right? But another one worked with the post office his entire life. And that's how he got into the community. He's done very well. His kids are doing very well, et cetera. And that's an important part of becoming part of the middle class here. And I'm a little disappointed personally to see throughout the entire country that we're cutting back on this access. Because I think while the old jobs that we used to do in government are disappearing, there are new ways that government can help. And we shouldn't only rely on the private sector, which is not a message that a lot of Italian Americans want to hear. But I think it's really important. When you look at state government, I thought your numbers were interesting again, that fewer are entering government, fewer Italian Americans are entering, but they're staying longer, and more of them are moving to senior positions, which I think is really important. And I decided, you know, what's going on in the legislature? How are we represented? I took a quick look. Actually, my numbers were very similar to yours. I came out with 25 Italian Americans. The sheet you gave me just a few minutes ago had 26. Because I knew the heritage of a lot of our people who don't have Italian-sounding names. I forgot Kathy Nolan. But Kathy's has a Italian mother, I believe. But when you look, it's interesting numbers. There are 26 out of 150 assembly members who have an Italian-American background. So that's about, well, my quick math is about 16%, which is in line with the numbers that you have. And it's in line with the population as well, which is interesting. Especially since the Italian-Americans don't live together anymore. You know, we left the Lower East Side, and you don't see populations of Italian Americans congregating that much. We've assimilated, so it's interesting that we still come out with the right numbers, so to speak, in the state legislature. There are populations of Italian Americans who do live together. I mean, I represent a district that's kind of split in two. I represent the town of Greenberg, where the Italian American population is significant, but not in the Democratic Party. So it's kind of significant for me to have won a primary in a community that was once seen as heavily Jewish. But I won a primary by 18 votes many years ago to the town board. And then once, as an Italian American, you get the Democratic line, now you're kind of in for life. Because the theory being, well, you pick up some of the Italian American votes, plus you have the Democratic line, you'll do very well. It's not always the case, but I did serve as a town councilman. Then I won a primary to get, or won a contested election to get to the county board, and then I had a primary before the assembly. But Greenberg is a very diverse community. So it has an Italian American population, it has a Jewish population, it has an African American, Hispanic population. It's a very diverse community. On the other hand, the northern one-third of my district is Mount Pleasant, which has a very significant Italian American population. But interestingly also, it's more Republican. So I took a look and I said, well, are the Italians all represented by Republicans in the state legislature? In the assembly, no. In the assembly, there are 15 Democrats and 11 Republicans. Now, it is interesting because we have a lot more Democrats than we do Republicans, but still, we are represented in both political parties, almost equally. 15 to 11 is not too lopsided. Also, there are 14 who have been there longer than me, well, including me, for six years or more, and there are 12 who are new. So we're still replacing those who leave. So we have 15 Democrats, 11 Republicans, 14 who have been there 6 years or more, including me, and 12 who've been there less. So it's a pretty good spread. So we're doing well, I think, in the assembly. Now, I didn't add up the Senate numbers. I don't know the senators that well, but that leaves about 20 senators. Out of the 26, it's 20 senators, 20 out of 63 is a very good percentage of Italian Americans in the Senate. So I didn't look to see what the breakdown is, but just a quick look, it seems to be spread over the two political parties as well. So I think that's a good sign. Now, having a governor with an Italian name, that's also a good sign. Because I think what happens is we've got to not only make people feel comfortable with their government, but we also have to encourage them. We have to act as an example. You lead by example. And I think Matilda Cuomo is doing a fine job of that, an excellent job of that. But, you know, so it's, you want to step back and be proud of the people who have names similar to yours. Because there still is some latent discrimination. We see that. I think, I have to be careful how I say this, with all of the discrimination right now in this country against other groups, it's less for us, but it's still there. And it's unfortunate that people have to discriminate. I don't know what it is that makes some people discriminate, and they have to look at skin color, whether their name has a vowel at the front of the name or the end of the name. For some reason, people have to distinguish themselves by some of these arbitrary factors. But there's no question that that's been an effect on us. Somebody talked about their changing the family name, et cetera. Well, we were discussing it before. My mother, when she became, you know, of employment age, she didn't speak Italian because my grandparents came from Italy, and they didn't want their kids to speak Italian. They wanted them to assimilate as quickly as possible because they felt that they were outsiders and being treated as outsiders. So Felicia Maggiacomo Capitasto became Phyllis Cabot. And she got her first job as Phyllis Cabot. And, you know, she was secretarial, that was her skills, and she worked forever, you know, as a secretary. She was very happy with that, but she found, interestingly enough, even my sister, who was much younger than I am, but went into an industry, not the tourist industry, but she was working with international trade or in this country. But for whatever reason, the company that she was with, she didn't feel comfortable. She changed her name from Felice Abinanti to Felice Abbey. and this wasn't that many years ago, but she just found that in the industry that she was in, she was better off not having an ethnic name. And it's unfortunate that people, you know, still feel the need to do that. She's left that industry. She's now, you know, a special ed teacher. She's got her own little business, but she stuck with the name, so she never went back to Abenanti. But it's just interesting how you see these little pieces of life and how people have to accommodate. So I commend you on your book. I agree with your assessment of where we need to go. You have some goals in there, and I think that's you're right. I would just say I think one, we have to increase the number of policymakers who have last names like ours. And secondly, I think we have to work actively to reduce that negative stereotype that you refer to in there. And the stigma that comes with it. And you know, that's somehow people still like to pigeonhole you. And that's we've got to work to change that. I think we've got to work to change that. Now, what's the roadmap to do that? I think one of the things that you highlighted is very important, and that is we've got to have more educators, more people in the education field with Italian-American last names who speak out, who become leaders in the intellectual world. I mean, heaven knows, we have had artists and writers and for centuries, right? So why are we not seen as intellectual leaders? I don't know why. But I think we need to have more people who lead in the intellectual community, the educational community, et cetera. And secondly, I think we need to have more electeds and other leaders because the more we do things, the more public attention we get, the more people become comfortable with a last name that ends in a vowel. And I think that's really important. We want everybody to assimilate in this country. But at the same time, we don't want to lose the heritage. And that's just one final point. That's why this organization is so important. Because we add to the quilt that is America. And we've got to preserve that quilt. We don't want to see some parts that we've contributed, and our history has contributed, to wither away. And then we leave a hole in that quilt. And we have so much to contribute. Our history has so much to contribute. There's so much we can learn from Italians and Italian Americans that we should become versed in it, and we should not be afraid to talk about it. So I appreciate you giving me a chance to come here today. And like I said, there's coffee and donuts outside. But thank you for your work.